Thanks everyone for joining me for this talk. So in today's session, I'll be talking to you about modularity. And basically, what do we understand when we speak about modularity in terms of the Java platform? So I've been having this session now for several times in different conferences. And along with some modifications about the new stuff that's coming up with the new release of the Java development kit. So just in short, who am I? I'm currently a software engineer at EPAM Bulgaria. I'm also one of the Bulgarian Java User Group leads, where we organize several conferences. One of them is called J Prime, where we invite speakers from all over the world, and we have two tracks in one day. We also have a number of sessions that we organize in the Java group as well. And I'm also an OpenJDK contributor, and my focus is mostly on Project Jigsaw, for which we'll be talking about today. So, for today's session, first we'll discuss what shall we understand when we talk about modularity. What is modularity in general, and how this concept applies to the Java platform. Then we shall discuss a standard modular implementation of a module system in the Java platform called OSGI. So how many of you have heard of OSGI? Okay, many. And how many of you like OSGI? Not many. Okay, understandable. After that, we'll see how this concept of modularity applies in the platform itself. So basically, we'll talk about Project Jigsaw and what's the current progress around modularizing the Java platform. And at the end, we shall see how the two technologies interoperate with each other. How you can build modules using both Jigsaw and OSGI. So modularity, what shall we understand when we talk about modularity? So you can consider that each Java library that you use, whether that's Hibernate, whether that's Java util logging, and so on and so forth, is a module on its own. So basically, you have built systems like Maven that allow you to manage these modules. And typically, when you develop a Java application, you put all of these libraries or modules in your class path. So this is the standard way we develop Java applications. However, we have several benefits when we talk about modules. So when you have a modular system, you have smaller modules that are more easily tested than a single monolithic application. You also have easier evolution of the system. So by having separate modules, you can more easily maintain your system and basically split the development of each module to a separate development team. Now, this sounds very good, but in practice, this implies that you might have a lot of communication with other teams when you implement your module, especially when you have some dependencies on other modules, of course. Also, modularization allows you to better maintain your modules and to develop them, of course. So here is a typical problem that we have with the standard mechanism that we have in the Java platform. In this particular example, I have some application that depends on two libraries. I have library A and library B. And on behalf of the two libraries, I have two different versions of library C. So library A depends on library C version 1.1. And library B depends on library C version 1.2. So if the two versions of the library C are not backward or forward compatible, imagine what would happen if you add them to the class path. Many of you have reached that problem when you have two different versions, incompatible versions in some cases of this library, on the class path. In that case, you have different options to cope with this inconsistency. You can either try to remove one version and use only the other. You can try to somehow patch the two versions so that they interoperate with each other, or any other type of hack you can think of. So this is the so-called jar-hell problem that's implied by the class path mechanism in the Java platform. So one of the aims of having a clear modular approach towards solving that problem is basically to have a modular system that allows you to dynamically manage independent modules. This is something that's currently lacking out of the box for the Java platform. And of course, we need to be able to somehow loosely coupled manner how do the different modules depend on each other. So here are some of the properties of such a module solution that's lacking in the platform. It should be able to manage modules, to somehow install them, uninstall them, start them, specify how do they depend on other modules. We should be able to deploy them somehow, either as part of the platform or as part of the module system itself. We should be able to have some versioning mechanism. So in the previous problem, we saw that here we have two different versions, but we add them both in the same namespace, and this introduces a lot of headache, of course. Also, we should be able to have some type of module repositories, or this is a central place where we can store modules. And of course, we should be able to manage the configuration of those modules. For example, module names, their dependencies, and so on and so forth. So these are the typical properties of a module system. And this applies not only to Java, but in general. So one of the solutions that currently many applications are using is the OSGI specification. As many of you pointed out, you've heard of OSGI. It's already a very mature technology, and it's continuing to evolve very rapidly. So just as a short review, what is OSGI? So OSGI, or the Open Services Gateway, is an open specification that specifies how to implement a module system that runs on top of the Java platform. It is introduced, of course, as part of the standard JCP processes to GSRs. These are GSR 8 and the newer one, GSR 291. So what is an OSGI runtime or an OSGI module system? So an OSGI runtime actually makes use of the standard Java class loading mechanism. And it provides a specification of how to load basically different modules, how to manage their life cycle inside of the module system itself, and how to package those modules in terms of the so-called bundles, or OSGI bundles. So, for example, many application servers are using OSGI as the basis of the application server itself in order to implement a mechanism for dynamically loading various types of web applications. It's not only web servers. There are many industries that are using OSGI for implementing a type of a module system that allows you to dynamically at runtime manage different modules, install and uninstall them. So here is how the state of a typical module looks like in OSGI. A bundle typically contains some source code, for example, Java source code. It may contain native files. It may contain some resources. It may even contain some web resources, such as HTML, CSS, JavaScript, depending on the needs of your application. So a bundle is simply a jar file that contains those types of resources along with the source code. And each bundle can be installed in the OSGI runtime. It can also be uninstalled. And once a bundle is installed, it can be started, stopped, or uninstalled, respectively. So this is the way how OSGI bundles are resolved at runtime. So the OSGI specification itself is layered. What do I mean by layered specification? So at the bottom of the specification, we have the hardware. And the hardware basically hosts the operating system, which hosts the Java virtual machine, which hosts an implementation of the OSGI specification. And that implementation is layered, meaning that, for example, the first layer, which is mandatory for all implementation, is the module layer. The module layer actually specifies this life cycle of the bundles, how to start them, how to stop them, how to register some callbacks that are invoked when the module is started, stopped, or uninstalled. The second layer is the life cycle layer, basically. That defines this life cycle that we have here. So the module layer actually provides the encapsulation of the modules inside of jar files. The lifecycle layer provides us with a mechanism of how to start, stop, and uninstall modules. We have also the so-called service registry, which allows us to specify how a particular module can expose services that can be consumed by other modules. So in essence, actually, the OSGI runtime defines two mechanisms for depending between modules. So one module can expose some packages. So we can expose some packages that can be consumed by other modules. And this is implemented by the module layer. Or we can have a more loosely coupled mechanism that allows us to specify or expose some services to the service register for OSGI. And other modules can consume them. So these are the two mechanisms that allow us to provide somehow dependency management for our OSGI plugins. Now, as I mentioned, the first mechanism is the so-called wire protocol. Or basically, a wire protocol just specifies what packages are visible to the outside world. So I have some metadata, some plugin information about the bundle that provides an explicit information of what packages are visible to other bundles. Now, on that behalf, other bundles can explicitly import those packages and use them, use classes from those public packages. On the other hand, we have the so-called service registry, which provides the second mechanism for specifying dependencies in OSGI. So we have some services that are exposed by some bundle, and we have some bundles that consume those services. And this is implemented by means of the so-called OSGI service registry, which is, of course, a more loosely coupled manner to specify dependencies. Now, here is the typical definition of a bundle. And this is the typical metadata that's specified for an OSGI bundle. So we have a standard manifest.mf file, which is packaged inside of the jar file of the bundle. And it specifies several things. We have the bundle symbolic name, which is the unique name of our bundle on our OSGI module. We also have some bundle version, which specifies the version of our module. We also have some activator class that implements some lifecycle methods as specified by the lifecycle layer of the OSGI specification. We can have some dependencies. For example, as you can see in this example, I have an export package attribute, which specifies one export package that I provide to the outside world. So for example, other bundles can use classes directly from the package ua.org.javaday.seminar.demo.utils. And on the other hand, my bundle uses the classes from the package ua.org.javaday.seminar.jigsaw.shared. And I can also specify the version of the package that I want to depend on. Now, this is the essential thing around the wire protocol specified by OSGI. I specify that I export some package, and optionally, I can specify a version for that package. And if I import some package, I can specify the version of the bundle from which I want to import the package. This means that, if you remember, at the beginning, we specified that we might have different versions of the same library on the class path. And with that mechanism, this actually resolves the so-called jar help problem, meaning that I can explicitly specify not only the package from which I want to import classes, but also the version of the other bundle. This means that I might have multiple versions of the same bundle inside the same OSGI runtime. And this, as you can see, allows us to manage better the dependencies that are specified by the OSGI platform, something that's currently lacking in the Java platform by default. So the OSGI specification continues to evolve. It has a number of extensions defined in the so-called OSGI compendium specification. For example, we might have an HTTP service that allows us to deploy web application as part of OSGI bundles, or having web applications that are part of different types of OSGI modules. And we have different types of services that are defined by this so-called OSGI compendium specification. That's actually an extension of the core OSGI specification that defines a standard module system for the Java platform. And the OSGI specification continues to evolve. So just a short demo on OSGI. So I'll be using Eclipse. I have a pretty simple OSGI bundle, which, let me just increase the font a little bit. Okay, can you now see better? Yep. Okay, I have a pretty basic OSGI bundle. So I have my bundle metadata specified by the manifest MF file. As you can see, I have one bundle which is called ua.org.javaday.bundle. Yeah? Yeah, of course. Maybe try with this one. Is it better now? Okay. So I have my bundle, I have some version, I have the some additional information such as, for example, who is the vendor or the manufacturer of the bundle. What else? I also have an activator class that implements some lifecycle methods that are executed when I do something with my bundle. For example, if I open the activator, it's a plain simple Java class that implements the bundle activator interface, which is an interface that comes from the Eclipse OSGI specification. So as you know, the Eclipse IDE uses OSGI to run plugins. So Eclipse is essentially an implementation of the Equinox OSGI runtime along with some additional extensions. So I have a method called start, which is executed when I start my bundle as part of the OSGI runtime. And I have a stop method, which is executed when I stop the bundle. I can also redefine install and uninstall as lifecycle methods. So now let me just start an OSGI console from Eclipse. Okay, so an OSGI console actually allows me to view what are the currently installed modules in the Eclipse IDE, for example. I'll say LB, which is shorthand for list bundles, and I can see what are the installed bundles inside of the Eclipse IDE. Now, if I want to install my OSGI bundle or OSGI module, I need to first build a jar file, for example, that allows me to deploy the package as part of the OSGI runtime. So I'm building this with Maven. I'll say Maven clean package, and I'll say --, offline. Yeah, I'm building this offline because I don't need to download any dependencies from the Maven repository. So it takes a while, and it fails because I have a mistake here. So it should be clean package. So it takes a few seconds to build my OSGI bundle. It packages the metadata along with the source files. Now, if I simply go to the target directory, I have my jar file already built. Now, I can install that OSGI bundle from the file system directly. I can say in the OSGI console, install file, and specify the full path to my OSGI bundle. So that's the full path to the jar file that's being built with Maven. Okay, I'll just change some things here. Now, if I do install on this, the OSGI runtime automatically assigns an identifier, which is in that case 1115. Using that identifier, I can check what is the state of the bundle. I can say bundle 1115. And as you can see, I have a status of installed. So my bundle is currently installed in the OSGI runtime. And now I can, for example, start it. I can say simply start 1115. And what it does is it just simply writes to the standard output here. So it says starting the test bundle. I can as well stop it. So I can say stop and provide the ID of the bundle again. So in that case, I'm just stopping the bundle. So this is how basically OSGI bundles are being developed. You write the bundle as a separate bundle project, you provide the metadata, and you test it by deploying constantly to an OSGI runtime. You might depend on some other services that are exposed by other bundles. You might depend on some other packages, Java packages, that are exposed by other modules. Now, so far, so good. However, why not having that mechanism as part of the standard Java platform? And in that regard, Project Jigsaw is being actively developed in the past several years, but it still hasn't made its way through to the Java platform. So how many of you have heard of Project Jigsaw? Oh, quite a lot of people, around 10. Okay, so what is Project Jigsaw in general? When speaking of the Java platform, we know that currently the code base of the Java platform is quite monolithic. So we have around 5,000 Java classes as part of the JDK installation. And for example, the rt.jar file that provides the Java runtime itself is quite monolithic. So it's just a single jar file that provides the entire runtime of the JVM. Now, in that sense, we might want to build something like an OSGI-like modules, but for the platform itself. So to somehow provide a mechanism to implement modules as part of the Java platform on one hand, and on the other hand, to split up the source code of the Java platform into modules. So here is it how the JDK looks like. It's just a whole mess of classes that are linked together. It's just a one very big monolithic application. Yeah? So in that particular case, it's a dependency analyzer. It's a custom script used by the OpenJDK team that actually was used to draw that diagram. I haven't used it to draw it myself. I just took the picture. Yeah. So in that sense, in version 8 of the Java platform, the OpenJDK team decided to introduce something called compact profiles. So compact profiles are just a restricted version of the JDK platform. So we have three compact profiles. Each one is named compact 1, compact 2, or compact 3. By the name of each one, you cannot understand what exactly is the scope of each compact profile. But in fact, when you go to the Oracle documentation, they specify which profile, which JDK classes does include. So basically, each profile is just a restricted version of the JDK platform. And this is a preliminary step that allows us to further analyze how to split the JDK platform into smaller modular units. So in version 8 of the Java platform, we can compile against a specific profile by specifying Java C minus profile and the name of the compact profile. So far, so good. However, this is not enough. So typically, the compact profiles are just three versions of the JDK with different amount of core library classes. We want to provide a more flexible mechanism that allows us to split the Java platform into multiple modules on one hand, and to basically allow developers to build these modules themselves. So in version JDK 9, additional effort was introduced to allow us to progress with the modularization of the Java platform. And modularization of the platform is a radical change. So this will typically change the mindset of Java developers. Currently, we are developing everything against the class path. We add libraries to the class path. When using even Maven or Gradle or any other type of build system, it adds everything to the class path. Now, with a modular version of the Java platform, we will start developing modules rather than jar files and libraries that are included to the class path. So early version of the Jigsaw project was available, and it specified a mechanism that allowed you to build modules as part of the Java platform. So typically, Oracle stated that such a version of the Java platform would stay backward compatible with older versions of the platform, but this will not be sufficient, for example, for some internal APIs. So in some sense, it's not very guaranteed that such a platform will be backward compatible with the previous versions of the Java platform. So what is exactly Project Jigsaw in that sense? So Project Jigsaw currently is defined as three JEPs, or Java Enhancement Proposals. So the first Java Enhancement Proposal, which is 200, defines how to structure the source code of the Java platform into multiple modules. So there is a single modules.xml file which resides in the source code of the OpenJDK project, which specifies how do modules depend on each other and what modules do we have in the Java platform. It's just a single XML file. So this was the first step. The second step is defined by Java Enhancement Proposal 201, which defines how to reorganize the source code of the platform itself into modules, or to provide modular structure for the source code of the Java platform. The third step is to actually restructure also the build images. So the build scripts of the Java platform need to be organized in a way that allows you to build a modular image of the Java platform. this is the current progress that's being done around Project Jigsaw, but currently there is no definition of a bundle metadata or a Jigsaw module metadata. So this is currently a work in progress that's being developed as part of a separate JSR, or the so-called JSR 376, which defines a standard specification for building a modular version of the Java platform. Now, here is a comparison of how does the old and the new structure of the Java source code repository look like. So in the old OpenJDK sources, we had a structure similar to having a source folder slash the name of the operating system, for example, Windows, Linux, Mac, something like this. Then slash classes or native, depending on whether we have some Java classes or some C++ files in the source code. Then slash the name of the package and the source files. Now in the new version of the Java platform, the source code is split into a modular structure that has the name of the module prepended in the name of the package. So we have source, then the name of the module, then the name of the operating system, for example, Linux, Windows, and so on. This depends on the for which platform is the source code of the Java platform being built. And this is basically the second step, splitting the source code into modules. And the third step, just to summarize, is to build a modular version of the JDK image. So currently, Project Jigsaw is in a relatively early exploratory phase. So it has been delayed now. It was expected for version JDK of 8 of JDK. Now it's being expected for version 9 of JDK, but who knows, it might be delayed further. So, however, we had an early access build which provided the proof of concept version for Project Jigsaw, which I will use for my demonstration. So the proof of concept version of the modular version of the Java platform provided two separate versions. The first version contained the entire code base of the Java platform split into modules and installed as part of the JDK. And the second version contained separate packages for the modules of the JDK and a very simple and small installable JDK which contained only the base classes and the runtime of the Java platform. So these were the two versions shipped by the early access proof of concept version for the Java platform. So what is a Jigsaw module in that sense? How did the OpenJDK team define the structure of a Jigsaw module? So a Jigsaw module, in a very similar sense to a OSGI bundle, contains Java classes, may contain native files, may contain resources, and so on. It's also packaged in a jar file, in a very similar fashion as OSGI bundles. However, a Jigsaw module is not resolvable during runtime. So typically, Jigsaw modules are intended to be cooperative at compile time. So you replace basically the class path mechanism, you leave it just for backward compatibility, but you introduce a separate mechanism, which is the so-called module path, that allows you to specify modules and not jar files or jar libraries in the class path. And basically, with that mechanism, you may, at compile time, dynamically specify different types of modules that you have when building your project. For example, imagine that you have some embedded device, for example, a mobile phone or any other type of embedded device, and you want to install only a minimalistic version of the JDK on that device. At some later point in time, you may want to include additional modules as part of that JDK installation. And that will become very simple with Project Jigsaw. It will allow you to install on demand separate modules as part of the JDK platform installation. So, are you aware currently what mechanism do we have for providing libraries as part of the JDK installation? Not on the class path. Anyone? Yeah, extension. So we have the so-called extension mechanism that allows us to provide Java libraries as part of the JDK installation. And we have the so-called extension class loader, which is one of the three class loaders we have standardly in the Java platform. We have the Bootstrap class loader that loads the Java runtime. We have the System class loader that loads the classes from the class path. And we have the so-called extension class loader, which loads those libraries that are part of the JDK platform installation. Now with Project Jigsaw, the extension class loader will be removed. So there will be no need for extension class loaders. However, custom class loaders will be introduced in a similar fashion as OSGI does. So for example, OSGI loads each bundle in a with a separate class loader. And in Jigsaw, the Java platform will load each Jigsaw module in a separate class loader, or the so-called module class loader. We have a single module which is called the Java base module, which encapsulates the Java runtime. This is the only module that must be installed at minimum in order to be able to have a fully running Java virtual machine. Yeah. Quite a lot of space. So, for example, how big is, for example, rt.jar file? 2-3 megabytes or something like this. So imagine that excluding all of the other JDK classes and stripping down rt.jar further and bundling it into a Java-based module as part of a Jigsaw, for example, if you build a Jigsaw bundle, then that will strip down the version of the JDK installation to maybe 1 megabyte or even less. At minimum, and that will contain only the Java runtime. Now, here was the initial proof of concept version of a Jigsaw metadata that was specified by the OpenJDK team. So the structure is somewhat very similar to the manifest MF file that OSGI uses. And for example, here, in this particular example, we define the structure of a basic module. So we have some module which is called ua.org.javaday.a with version 1.0, and it requires some other version to be available on the class path during compile time, which is ua.org.javaday.b, and the version of that other module b must be between 2 inclusive and 3 exclusive, and that metadata is specified in the so-called module-info.java file. Currently, this syntax is an extension of the Java language. So this has anyone an idea of why this is called module-info.java? Why do we define the format as a Java file and specify a module-info as the name? We have so-called package-info.java. Maybe not many of you use it, but in package-info.java you can specify, for example, some Java doc for your package at the package level. So in that sense, the Jigsaw team decided to use this information to specify the metadata in a module-info.java file. In the second example, we require two other modules to be available at compile time in the module path. So these are modules B and module C with some particular version. As you can see here, we can specify version ranges on the modules upon which we depend. And this is also available in OSGI. So currently, module versions and the mechanism for specifying module versions in Jigsaw are derived on the basis of Debian packages. And the intention here is to be able to install Jigsaw modules as part of a package manager, as part of the operating system package manager. And this applies, of course, for operating systems that have package managers, such as Debian-based distributions. Here is another example. So imagine that at a later point in time, we might additionally install a Jigsaw module. So we may specify that we depend optionally on that module. We specify requires optional some other module. In this example, this is JDK-Corba. This means that I'll be able to compile the A module, but without having the JDK-Corba module on my module path. I can also require local modules. So local modules are something like mixins. If someone has written in Ruby or in latest versions of C++, we have mixins which basically include the source code of module B as part of the same class loader of module A. Yeah, question? Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, so in this particular example, the class loader of module A will load module B as part of the same namespace of module A. But if we don't depend on it locally, then it will load module B in a separate class loader. It might cause problems, for example, if you have the same class defined in both module A and module B, because they will be in the same namespace. And if you don't depend locally on module B, then even if you have two classes with the same name in the two modules, it will be no problem. Because in that case, the namespace is defined by both the class loader and the fully qualified name of the class. Here is another... Yeah? Yeah.
Would it be possible to load two modules with like orthogonal functionality? Because mixins are concepts that is used to actually work around the diamond problem.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So multiple inheritance. So are modules used in the same way?
In this regard, local modules are used. For example, if you have let's say a very big module that you want to split somehow. And basically want to load all of the classes as part of the namespace schema. Yeah. So this is a good question. For example, how does OSGI deal with cyclic dependencies? Does anyone know? It tries to detect whether we have a kind of a cyclic dependencies when it tries to resolve the modules. And in terms of Jigsaw, this should be able to, or the Java platform should be able to determine if we have a cyclic dependency at compile time. So you won't be able to compile your application if you have cyclic dependency between the modules. Okay, in this particular example, I expose one package and one class. So I have, again, my A module, and it exports a package called ua.org.javaday.a.seminar.samples. However, I also expose a particular Java class, something which is lacking in OSGI. In OSGI, I can export some only packages. And in Jigsaw, I should be able to export also class files, Java classes. I can also specify something like permissions that provide some type of visibility for other modules. So I can say that currently my module A exports some package which is ua.org.javaday.a.seminar, and that package can be imported only by module B. If another module tries to import that package, it won't be available to do so. So this is a mechanism that specifies something like an access control for modules. This is analogous to how I can specify services in Jigsaw. So in OSGI, we mentioned that the second mechanism for specifying dependencies is via the service registry. In Jigsaw, we have an alternative mechanism, we'll see in a minute. But currently, I can specify an alternative name for my module. So I have an ua.org.javaday.a module, and I can specify a synonymous name, which is ua.org.javaday.first. It's just an alternative name for my module. Also, modules can be runnable. In the same manner, I have a runnable jar file where I can specify a main entry point. I can also specify a main entry point in my module. And this is by means of the class attribute inside of the module metadata. I say class, and then the fully qualified name of the class that has a main method. And then I can invoke that module by specifying Java minus M and the name of the module. I can also define views. So views are also an alternative mechanism for providing access control between modules. And I can have multiple views that define, in a way, different views for different other modules in the system. So, for example, for module B, I define a view that allows module B to import the seminar package defined by module A. And I can have multiple views inside of the module metadata. It's just a mechanism for specifying access control. And then I can specify services, as I already mentioned. So I can say provides service, then some interface, and then some implementation. This is very similar to how I specify services in OSGI. I define some interface and some implementation of that interface, or multiple implementations. And then I specify that my module, in that case module A, exports that service in some form of a central registry that's managed by the JDK platform. So the JDK platform makes use of the so-called service locator, which is an API that's already existing in the JDK platform, but it's not very widely used. And that API allows us to have a mechanism very similar to the way how OSGI behaves. Some jar file exposes some service, and some other jar file consumes that service. And this mechanism is used to provide the support for having services in Jigsaw modules. Another module can specify that it requires some service. So module B in that case specifies that it requires the service, which is in that case the test service interface, which is exported by module A. If this service is missing and an implementation of that service is missing at compile time, I will not be able to compile my module. Remember, everything here is done at compile time. I can also have optional services, which means that if the service is missing at compile time, I'll be able to compile my module, but I risk the fact that if I try to use that service, I can get, for example, a null pointer exception, because I don't have any implementation of the services available. So you may have asked yourselves, well, so far so good, but why does Project Jigsaw copies at so much concepts from OSGI, and why not use OSGI to implement such a module system as part of the JDK platform itself? And an interesting answer to that question is given by the chief architect of the platform, Mark Reinhold. So he mentions that the OSGI specification is defined so that modular systems can be implemented in Java, but they are comparative only at runtime and not at compile time. So in that sense, OSGI is not suitable to provide a compile time mechanism for specifying modules in the Java platform. Yeah, but there is another project currently that's being researched, and it provides mechanism for interoperability between the two systems. And we'll look shortly what is that project and how, what points of interoperability do we have between the two systems. But yeah, you can have, for example, a module version of the Java platform that runs OSGI at some point in time when Project Jigsaw is available. However, on the other hand, on the other side of the coin, Peter Kreese, which is one of the main guys behind the OSGI specification, mentions that it's not necessary to define such a heavyweight mechanism for specifying modules as part of the Java platform, but you can just extend the information of the packages in the class file, in the compiled class file, with additional information about the version of the class. So in that sense, Peter Kreese says that it's just enough to add a version to the name of the package we import, and that will be sufficient to implement a module system in the Java platform. Okay, so now let's see some demo on Project Jigsaw. Okay, so I have two versions of the Java platform which are built with modularity in mind. So, I'll just go to the installation of one of these versions I have. So let me just increase the font a little bit. Okay, I guess this is the maximum. So I'll just go to the installation of this JDK, which I have. And I'll go to the bin directory. So I'll go to JRE base image. I'll go to bin. Now, as part of a module installation, I have a number of additional tools that allow me to manage modules as part of the Java platform. Okay. Now let me just open the version with already pre-installed packages. Now if I go to the bin directory, I have the so-called JMod tool, which is shorthand for Java modules. It's a tool that allows me to actually uninstall and uninstall modules as part of the JDK installation. If I say JMod list, I can see what modules do I have installed as part of the JDK platform. For example, I have jdk.jndi, I have jdk.jdbc module, I have jdk.security.acl module, and so on and so forth. So you can see that this version of the JDK platform is already modularized, and it has modules as part of the JDK core classes instead of a single monolithic application. Now, I have a pretty simple Jigsaw module that I have. Now, let's look at the module metadata first. I have a module-info.java file, which is ua.org.javaday. It has version 1.0. It exports one package, which is ua.org.javaday. It requires the JDK base module. So this module, JDK base, is required by all modules. So when you write a Jigsaw module, you need always to include this JDK.base module. And I also specify a main entry point for my module. So I specify that this module is runnable, and I provide the fully qualified name of that class, which is ua.org.javaday.main, which is that class over here. It just prints out hello Jigsaw. As you can see, Eclipse cannot compile this module-info.java file because support for different types of IDEs is currently not available for Jigsaw. And it won't be available until an official release of the JDK platform is available that specifies the module metadata. Remember, this is just a proof of concept version that was built by the OpenJDK team. So now I want to compile this project. I want to compile this module, and I'll be using the Java C tool. I have a small cheat sheet. So in order to compile this, the first thing I want to do actually is list all of the source files I have in my project. And the reason I'm doing this is because Java C can compile multiple classes based on the number of classes specified in just a single text file. So now that I list the source files, if I open this file, I'll see that I have three Java sources. One is module info, the other one is the main class I have, and the third one is just some utility class I have in the package I export from my module. And now I want to compile this. I'll use that long command, which is javac minus d specifies the directory that contains the file that lists all of the Java files. Then I specify this module path, which I mentioned about. So module path actually is an alternative to the class path that allows us to specify modules at compile time. Then I specify that my module path is the location of where my module will be built. And then I specify an alias to the file that contains the source files of my Jigsaw project. So let's compile this. Okay, it takes a while and compiles. If I go back to that directory, I can see that I already have my module info Java file compiled into a class file, and I also have my other classes compiled. Now that I have built my Jigsaw module, I want to package it. I want to make it a deployable unit. For that reason, I'll be using another tool, which is called JPKG, which is part of the JDK platform installation. I'll say jpkg minus m, which is shorthand for module, and I'll specify the full path to where my module is being built. After that, I'll say jmod and specify the name of the jmod file that I want as an output, which is ua.org.javaday. Now, if I list all of the files here, you can see that I have a JMOD file which is being built into the current directory. Now, I want to install that module as part of the JDK installation. I'll say JMOD install, and I'll specify the name of that JMOD package. JMOD install takes a while to install the module. Now that the module is installed, if I say JMOD list again, I can see here that I have my module already installed, which is here. Now I've installed my module as part of the standard JDK platform, and this is the way I actually am able to build my Jigsaw module. Okay, so this was in short about Jigsaw, and just as a final word, there is an effort to provide interoperability between Project Jigsaw and Project OSGI, which is called Project Penrose, and it allows me to provide different mechanisms to build the same module as either a Jigsaw module or as an OSGI bundle, and basically to provide the same metadata for both. Now, Project Penrose is currently under active development, but it's being suspended until Project Jigsaw is developed. So when do we expect Project Jigsaw? Maybe never. Maybe in 2016. It depends on the progress that defines the module metadata. And that's it, basically. If you want to contribute, you can use the following mailing lists. You can follow the mailing lists. You can check out the source code of Project Jigsaw and contribute, basically. So that's it. Thank you. Yeah, I think... Oh, okay. So I have time for three questions? For the people who ask questions. Okay, you have one. Yeah. Basically, this allows you basically to define modules as part of the JDK platform and to install these modules as part of the JDK platform, or just to compile against the platform classes. With different modules, typically it is expected that you should be able to load modules from different directories. For example, if you have multiple directories with modules, you can specify all of these directories on the module path. In a similar manner, you specify dependencies on the class path. So you should be able to load modules from different locations, and also from, for example, from a URL or from an FTP server. Yeah. Okay. Sorry? No, it's currently under progress. As we specified, we have three Java enhancement proposals, and currently only the module source code is being split into modular structure, and we have the JDK images split into multiple modules, but we don't have the metadata. So these things I showed you here, this was an early access version that specified the bundle method, the module metadata, but this they decided to drop this specification, and now we don't have a module info.java file, but we'll have something very similar to that that specifies the Jigsaw module metadata. So this is the one thing that's currently lacking from the Java platform in order to be able to have a fully comparative at compile time modular system for the Java platform. Yes, you can use modules without JMODs. You are not obliged to build JMOD packages out of them. You do this only for the ease of distributing them as part of separate repositories or installing them as part of a JDK installation. But you can include the compiled module as part of the module path without building a JMOD package. Yes. It's the same with OSGI, for example. If you want to turn a library into an OSGI bundle, you have to provide some metadata, for example. You want to specify a manifest.mf file that specifies which packages are exported from that library. And you can use some tools such as BND that allow you to dynamically generate this metadata out of the library.
You can
Yes, of course. Yes, of course, yeah.